what I will try to present is mathematics is going to be a new view of information, which now is very prominent in quantum field theory and quantum gravity, but the traces of it are very old. And what I would be interested in is to make these connections in time between this vision of information as anadyomene, which comes from Hesiodus' theogony, and I will try to make a kind of a journey in time and to examine major thinkers and figures who have used in their work this notion of information as anadyomene. But first of all, I would like to start with what information is in this context. So information is the capacity of forming distinguishable spectral differences within intrinsically and objectively foamy surroundings laden by the presence of obstacles. So in this kind of environments, the distinctions between continuous and discrete is more or less meaningless. We have intrinsically foams and clouds, and we try out of it to get information. A very nice painting by George Cruikshank, what you can find in the Victoria and Albert Museum, and another version at the Princeton Institute of Advanced Study, tries to depict this notion of anadyomene, which comes from the theogony of Hesiodus. So what anadyomene means in this context? Anadyomene means spectrally emerging through another foamy level of hypostasis into which some seed or germ has been initially immersed. So this is the notion of anadyomene that I will try to talk about, and I will connect with this new vision of what information is. Above this you can see the picture of the quantum vacuum. As you can see, this is a totally foam, totally foamy substance or structure. You cannot really distinguish points, or you cannot define the usual notion of topology in this kind of spaces. They are laden with singularities, tunnels, space-time tunnels, wormholes, black holes, and all other types of singularities that you can think about. So the question is that if we start from such a context, can we have a notion of information which is working? I would like to start with the genesis of this idea of anadyomene, which is personified in the myth of Aphrodite and is contained in Hesiodus' Theogony. So the story is that Kronos, which stands for Chronos, is the ancient Greek name for time, took a sickle and cut off the genitals of his father, Uranus, a quite tragic from a modern viewing thing, but this is all symbolic, and threw them into the sea. Then a white foam spread around from which Aphrodite was born, emerging from her oceanic conception as a fully grown goddess. Now I would like to see this myth from if this myth has to say anything about a type of generation of information which is personified in the figure of Aphrodite. So the points that I can see here are the following, that first of all, that this is an obstacle bracing process which involves a metaphora, okay, between two different levels. The one is the level of Uranus, and the other is the level of Gaia. And these levels are incongruent. So they cannot, they are incommensurable as level of hypostasis. So some bridges are needed in order to be able to make a metaphora through these levels. In the myth, this process of metaphora is initiated by Chronos, about which we can think as a kind of a unitary circular flow, very similar actually to what we call unitary time evolution in quantum mechanics, which instantiates a reciprocal connectivity in terms of bridges between these two levels, in terms of a flow. This is not yet information. This is a kind of communication flow. Then we have the notion of Aphros, which is the first synthetic of the name Aphrodite. And in Greek, Aphros means exactly this, the form of indistinguishability or ambiguity or uncertainty. The next important element is that we have a process which is a process of virtual growth amid the form. So it's together with the form. Aphrodite does not come immediately out of the sea. There is a bridge, and in this bridge you can imagine Aphrodite non-separable, entangled, we could say in quantum terms, with this form, until by reaching at the upper level of Uranus, we have a kind of spectral emergence, which is depicted very nicely in this painting of Cruikshank. So the notion of spectrum is very important here. So we have a spectral emergence, but this happens through a process of symmetry breaking. And the symmetry breaking is exactly the breaking from the foam. So I would like now to take this notion of information as Anadyomene, to use as a kind of motif and examine some major figures in the history of not only mathematics but natural philosophy and poetry, where in my reading they display all these characteristics, which I explained before in this theogony account of Hesiodus. So they think of information as emerging through another level, through a process of symmetry breaking. So these guys that you see here, you start from, this is Hesiodus, okay? This is Homer. This is Thales from Miletus. This is Pythagoras, this is Galois, this is Riemann, Poincaré, and Alexander Grothendieck. So this will be my eight, I like to think of them as sirens, which exactly follow this motif of information as anadyomene. And this I will, in my talk, I will explain how this is manifested in this particular case. The model that I use to make these comparisons is what I call the model of natural communication. And I call it like this because it always involves at least two different levels of hypostasis. So you have an upper level here, which is the level where the obstacles are. The notion of obstacle is very general. It doesn't have to be topological. Any type of obstruction or inaccessibility can count as an obstacle. So instead of going through the obstacle, there is a bridge moving to another level. This bridge has to be natural in a sense. I will explain what natural means in this context. Then you move at another level. This can be a level of magnitudes, can be a level of structure, or another category-theoretic level. Or you can imagine transformations between algebra and geometry, or between algebra and topology, where through this path here, you are able to start embracing the obstacle. It's a process of circulation. And this is the notion of metaphora existing in the natural philosophy of the ancient Greeks. For example, this is the notion that Aristotle was talking as metavolí. So you reach this level and then you need to start ascending back. You can think of this bridge here as the encoding bridge and the inverse as the decoding bridge. And in this way, the model of natural communication becomes a kind of cryptographic and metaphorical at the same time. The idea is that you try to initiate a type of flow here, as you can see. This is just a skeleton through which you have a three-stage ordered, a resolution process. And in this way, you can think from an algebraic perspective, the levels W and T, they become conjugate to each other with respect to the bridges S and the inverse. Now there are two different types of bridges. These bridges can be exact inverses, and then a kind of group theoretic or groupoid structure emerges. Or in the more general sense, they can be only conceptually inverse, what in the field of category theory is called adjoint functors. So I think that this is the central idea, actually, of category theory, to form this kind of adjunction, which I find very, very crucial for understanding what information is as emerging from another level. And also resonates very nicely with the ancient Greek notion of logos and the notion of a gnomon as well. The most precise mathematically description of the notion of a gnomon was formed during the Alexandrian times of the Hellenistic period by Eron, who defined the gnomon as a kind of form which, when adjoined to another form, which is in general foamy or indeterminate, it can produce a spectrum. This spectrum can be a spectrum of self-similarity, or we can say in modern terms it can give a kind of equivalence relation through which we get a partition spectrum, but it can also apply in a topological context. It's very general, this definition. And ancient Greek geometers, for example, I can say Eudoxus, was working with this notion of gnomon implicitly. Also Archimedes, the notion of a spiral. He thought of a spiral as a kind of transformation bridge between the circle and the diameter. So I see all these concepts emerging back through the development of admittedly the most abstract part of modern mathematics, which is category theory. And all this is encapsulated in this notion of an adjunction. So it's a pair of adjoint functors which connects together in terms of bridges to different categorical levels of structure. In case that these bridges are inverse in the sense of category theory, you can get this what is called the duality. Like you have the duality between topological spaces and a type of algebras called sister algebras. So you play between topological and algebraic level. Now, how you can see the anatomy. I forgot to mention something that which is important, that I tend to see this this kind of circulation process or the natural communication model from four different perspectives. So I tend to see it from the perspective of algebra, which is what I called this conjugation process, which comes from group theory, actually. I tend to see it in terms of geometry, the theory, for example, of manifolds, differential manifolds, which is expressed as the Atlas principle. I see it from a topological point of view, where you have this idea of deformation invariance using homotopy. But I like to see it through the perspective of harmony and music. Mathematically, is the field of harmonic analysis. So you can see the same type of game operating within four different articulations. And I would like to think of these articulations as different threads, okay, through which you can start embracing obstacles of any particular form. I have to go a little more fast. I would like to point out very briefly at the properties that this we can agree to call this type of thing a motivic key. So I like very much the harmonic perspective. So we have the first idea is that you have a key extension in depth, so you can have a stacking of different things like this. So you can substitute this part here with another circulation, so you have a process of stacking. You have also a process of extension in length, which gives a type of product, algebraic product. And it's good to observe that without the middle part, this key becomes totally obsolete, right? Because if these bridges are totally inverse, they cancel out. So the middle part of the different level is very important for this circulation to work. I just want to give you some examples of this type of keys that everybody's more or less familiar with. Is this, you can think of infinitesimal keys, okay? You see exactly the same process of generating infinitesimal differences. You can think of scaffoldings or temporary folding devices, where the middle part is a part of stability, like my hand, okay? You can think of keys who have the property that equals their inverse, and this is in mathematics they are called involutions. And also who can generate cycles out of keys. So it's just a process of iterating this key formation, where you end up with cycles. And in case of group structure, this is what's called the group commutator. And finally, you can have a kind of localization of this idea of a key. You have the idea of parameterized keys, where you see that the first bridge is indexed by a localizing parameter A, and also the inverse bridge is localized with respect to a different parameter B. Okay? So you want to include some kind of locality requirement. The first example that comes into mind of how these things work, at least in a geometric context, is this idea of a smooth manifold. I want to point out that the whole idea of a smooth manifold, starting from, of course, from the concepts that Riemann used, has to do with the idea of transfer. This transfer is this idea of metaphora that I was talking about. So you want to transfer the differentiability structure from Euclidean spaces to abstract spaces, which are called manifolds. Okay? So you want to start locally putting coordinates by making local patches on unknown spaces or spaces which you cannot have some kind of global behavior, which is not which is not trivial, like in the case of a Euclidean space. Now, how you do it? You take two patches. So you map one patch here, the U patch, to a patch on a Euclidean space. This is my encoding bridge here. Then from this you define a diffeomorphism at the level of Euclidean spaces. Okay? So the image is another patch. And then you take the inverse bridge to come back. Now you can see that this whole thing appears in this kind of scheme, which is exactly what I was talking before about this conjugation scheme, right? Where you see that psi and phi and phi, they are conjugate, they are inverse, and in this way the manifold and the Euclidean space become conjugate locally. But the whole thing is this circulation that I want to point out is the notion of transfer of a smooth structure from the Euclidean from a Euclidean space to a manifold. And using this construction, then you can make concatenations, you know, reasonable concatenations, and you end up with the idea of the atlas. This is the atlas principle. This is the major thing that you do in geometry today, in differential geometry. Now, on topology, how this scheme appears is through the idea of homotopy of based loops and the idea of deformation invariance. And I want to point out this notion of obstacle that I was talking about, where you can see here this depiction. So you have a based point on a topological space where you base your loops, and then you throw these loops like lassos. And you see that these loops, which encircle an obstacle, cannot be contracted to this point, like in this case here, where there is no obstacle. All these loops here, they can be contracted at the base point, but you cannot do this thing here. So you have different types of loops by depending on the number of circulation around the obstacle. And this is now encoded in what we call fundamental group in the field of algebraic topology. Okay, so loops that can be deformed to each other are called homotopic. Homotopic classes of loops form a group which is called the fundamental group of the topological space. And if my space is simply connected, then the fundamental group is trivial. So the fundamental group is an algebraic way to encode this notion of obstacle. Okay, for example, when you have a puncture on a plane, okay, it's this type of what I call obstacles. Now, the important thing is that if you find the fundamental group of a topological space through the spectrum that you generate here, this is a structural invariant of the space. So you can answer the questions when two topological spaces are homeomorphic to each other. If they have a different fundamental group, they cannot be homeomorphic. Okay? So you see how you can generate information about topological spaces by using the homotopy idea and by defining the invariants in terms of the fundamental group. So you play at two different levels, topological level and at the level of algebra, group structures. So in the simplest case, you have this at the fundamental group of the circle, which is exactly, so you take all possible loops, okay, surrounding the circle or the puncture in the plane. And these loops here, they can be distinguished. The only way they can be distinguished is by their winding number or their degree, as it's called in topology, right? And in this way, we make equivalence classes of loops. So we produce a spectrum. We produce a partition spectrum, which is very simple. It's the group of the integers. So we see now the integers as the fundamental group within a topological structure. It's a new, totally new vision of what an integer is. Through this now, we can think of the unfolding, okay, in what is called the universal covering space of the circle as the real line, okay, through the exponential mapping. This is very important, probably the most important function in mathematics, the complex exponential function. So the real line, which now it's a spiral here, okay, is simply connected, and so it is the universal covering space of the circle. Now the symmetries of the real line, which leave the circle invariant, is just this discrete k numbers which belongs to the integers. So I would like to see now in this picture. This is the universal covering space of the circle in the form of a helix or a spiral. And this is the filled inversion, which comes in the form of a helicoid, which is the initial vision of Riemann about the idea of a universal covering surface of any type of Riemann surface which has holes or it is of a non-trivial genus, as it's called. Now I would like to see in this picture four types of aspects. The one is the harmonic, the other is the algebraic, the third is the topological, and the fourth is the geometric. So where are these four aspects? The harmonic aspect comes from the notion of period. Periods of loops which encircle this obstacle here, this puncture. This idea of a period now is translated into the idea of a frequency. Frequency is the number of cycles per unit of time. So you create a frequency spectrum here, which has to be thought harmonically, in a musical way. This you can see in harmonic analysis, this is the function of the Fourier transformation. It's used in both in signal analysis, but also in quantum mechanics. And it expresses this intrinsic uncertainty between energy and time. Where is the topological aspect? The topological aspect is this notion of obstacle here. The algebraic aspect, it comes into the using the group Z in order to index the different discrete stairs of the helix. And where is the geometric aspect? The geometric aspect is the universal covering space, which is simply connected space. So you see all four aspects appearing in this form, which I consider very fundamental, and in functional terms, the encoding bridge now is the complex exponential function, whereas the inverse bridge is the complex logarithm, which involves branching. Now, the question is, can we unify together all these aspects? And it turns out that we can by using a structure which is called a sieve, but a sieve together with a connective structure. Okay? The idea of a sieve, through which you can see all these type of ribbon surfaces, manifolds, is that you have a way of gluing local information together, which is depicted here in terms of compatibility of colors, from the local to the global level. So you see in these chromatic depictions how this kind of thing works, how you have the unfolding in a type of covering space here. You see the compatibility between local regions. And the other, the same here, okay, you can see, you can think of this compatibility as a kind of spectral compatibility. But you have an extra thing, which is the aspect of metaphora that I'm talking about. In complex analysis, this is called the process of analytic continuation. This is what metaphora is. So locally, you put disks, and you try to extend, you know, local disks compatible along paths. So in this way, the local global compatibility together with a connectivity structure, which you can think, for example, in this case, in terms of disks which are glued together and extend, you have a sieve together with a connection, together with a connective structure. And now you can prove that, I will mention it as a theorem, that the what I called motive key, from the category theoretical point of view, with these properties, which make it its anatomy, is equivalent always with a sieve together with a connection. And this notion is fundamental in algebraic topology, in algebraic geometry, and now in physics as well. So let's see now, I come back to the heroes of my story, to the figures I'm talking about, and I try to see this natural communication key, this motif key, between what levels it operates in each of these cases. You may be surprised because you see here Hesiodos and Homer appearing through a mathematical point of view. But it's very natural, actually. And what is the case for these two people here? First, in the case of Hesiodos, the problem that Hesiodos had was about the genesis of the gods. That's why he wrote Theogony. It's about the genesis of gods. And in particular, in this case that I examine, is the genesis of Aphrodite. This expressed in music. It's a harmonic problem. It is resolved for Hesiodos at the level of geometry, okay? Because if you see how Aphrodite emerges out of the foam, is as a fully formed figure, okay? And this is the meaning of Anadyomene. This is the geometric figure that he gives to Aphrodite. Now, in the case of Homer, what is the problem of Homer? Why he writes the Odyssey? If you read the first verse of the Odyssey, it says, «Όσα μη ένεπε μούσα πολύτροπον, όμαλα πόλα». What it means? Oh, tell me, Musa, about the twists and turns in time of this man of Odysseus. What is this, the twists and turns? It's topology. And he solves his problem by the way of writing his style is prosody. Prosody is a form of algebra. Okay, from here, after your initial surprise, you can see about Thales, Pythagoras, Galois, Riemann, Poincaré, and Grothendieck. How they operate, I will explain it in more detail if I have time. I don't know how much time I have.
Five to 10 minutes more.
Yeah, okay. I'm not even in the middle, but sorry. Okay, let me very briefly then explain at this point this information emerging as anadyomene from the rest of my figures. So Thales, his problem was in geometry. He wanted to measure the height of the pyramid. It's a geometric problem. What he did is he used light and he used shadows. A shadow is an intrinsically topological thing. Of course, if you fix a particular time of the day, then you have a measure of comparison between the shadows of different objects. But still, the domain through which you go from the level of geometry to the level of topology through shadows is the way that the theory of homothesis is expressed by Thales. A totally geometric, very nice, beautiful theory of homothesis, which involves these two levels. The problem of Pythagoras, what was Pythagoras? Pythagoras was a virtuoso in the Orphic lyre. He was a musician. He was not a geometer. His problem was to understand the notion of a consonance. It was a harmonic problem. What he did is to transform a problem of harmony into a problem of geometry. How? By making the correspondences between consonances and geometrical musical intervals. The scale, the musical scale that we still use today dates back in this conception of Pythagoras to transform harmonic consonances into geometric musical intervals. And this transformation is of a logarithmic nature. When you go from harmony to geometry, it's a logarithmic process. Aristotle describes in his metaphysics this as the process of antaneresis, which is a way to connect again with this idea of natural transformations between different domains in category theory, and the whole idea of adjoint functors. In the case of Galois, we have a problem at the level of algebra, is the solution of polynomial equations. And Galois, in a single stroke of genius, he gives a single criterion without having to examine the degree of each equation. This is called the method of solvability of groups. What is the nature of this method of group solvability? I don't have time now, but I can show that this is a generalization of the Pythagorean method of antaneresis. He uses, in the case of Galois, it has a structural form. He uses normal subgroups, so subgroups which are invariant under conjugation, and he initiates a process of division, which is a totally harmonic division, until with this criterion, by reaching at the last step of this process, he examines if a group is solvable or not. Now, if we see this in terms of geometry, this is a form of the Euclidean algorithm, okay, which I suppose you know everybody is familiar with how to find greatest common divisors or least common multiples. What about Riemann? Riemann's problem is in geometry, and he solves it through topology. How he solves it through topology? By thinking what is the notion of multiple connectivity. Because in geometry, we have the property of a simply connected space. Now Riemann expresses this property through the property of multiple connectivity. And the outcome of this procedure is what is called the Riemann mapping theorem or uniformization theorem, where you can see that every simply connected Riemann surface, so geometric surface, comes from three types of things. It's the universal covering space of either the sphere, either the complex plane, or a surface which has non-trivial genus, like a torus. In the case of Poincaré, we have a problem in topology, the problem of homeomorphism, which is solved at the level of algebra through a factorial construction which involves the notion of homotopy groups and homology groups. Okay? And finding these invariants here, he can say when two spaces are homeomorphic or not. In the case of Grothendieck, you can depict many possible bridges between these things here, but I would like to connect it with the work of Poincaré and Galois and Riemann. This comes to Grothendieck's theory of the fundamental group, which is a problem of algebra, so Grothendieck wants to have an algebraic notion of the fundamental group, not a transcendental one. And his construction of what is called Galois covering space, universal covering space of Galois, it integrates the ideas of Galois and Riemann, and his construction is of a harmonic form. And actually, in the end of his life, he was looking for this kind of, he called it motivic cohomology. It is written all his thoughts in his autobiography. And from there, you can see that it's totally harmonic, musical, the way of thinking about this universal structural invariants, which unify together all possible cohomological or homological invariants that we had up to that time. So my point now is that these figures here, they make up a topos of resonance, to which I come right now to investigate. And 5 more minutes, if I have. And I want to think about this topos of resonance as follows. We are used in the notion of the real line as the chronological ordering of events in one linear dimension. And now, what I want to make is that if two figures like what I explained before, in different historical times, they have the same germ of a concept through which they solve the problem using this Anadyomene method, okay, so through a different level. There is a bridge in time which connects them. Now, in technical terms, you can think of it as a kind of analytic continuation in the upper half complex plane. In this way, I want to get a spectral or chromatic geometry through which I want to take a spectrum through which I can tessellate history on the pattern of information as Anadyomene. So I want to end up to something like this. So if you imagine that I used 8 figures, so 8 figures, if I connect them in the upper half plane, the topos of resonance between them, it has to be of a hyperbolic type, okay? Because in a Euclidean space, the angle between two sides of an octagon is 135 degrees. Now I want to be able to connect them in a way that the total sum of the angles is 360 degrees. So what I get is a hyperbolic octagon, and here is the topos of resonance of the information as Anadyomene, which comes out of these figures. Now, with this topos of resonance, I want to think harmonically, and I want to see a tiling of history by resonance echo of this fundamental domain. So this geometric construction, I want to see it as a harmonic construction, which was actually the principle of construction of the ancient Greek theaters. So by using this fundamental domain, I can make iterations and I can tile up the whole plane. This is the hyperbolic plane is equivalent with the what is called the Poincaré disk model of hyperbolic geometry. So you end up with this kind of tiling. And okay, I just finished with this. Okay. Now I want to start playing between the level of geometry and the level of topology again. So you see here the octagon, the hyperbolic octagon, as the fundamental domain of the simply connected universal covering space of what? That's the question. And if I use Riemann, this is the universal covering space of this thing here, which is the double hole torus. And you may ask me, what is the meaning now of these two holes? I want to think of them, what is the exemplification of genus 2, of this type of foam. I think of it as a kind of foam here. Where the octagon is the ethnography of connectivity of this foam. Now think of each of these articulating threads. They end up in making loops, and these loops are of four types. Which are these four types? It's the types that my figures have made the transformation between domains. So there is this, which is the harmonic. There is this, which is the algebraic. There is this, which is the topological, and this, which is the geometric. In this way, I get a resonance topos as a simply connected geometric octagonal fundamental domain of unfolding the double torus. The double hole, I interpreted it as the notion of complementarity. And what is the notion of complementarity? I tend to think it as the complementarity between the visual and the acoustic domain. So in the case of the visual, I would put geometry and topology. And in the case of the acoustic, I would put harmony and algebra. So we get the resonance topos, which is the tiling of the whole plane. And I finish here. And I want to think you now of this fundamental domain, which is the resonance topos, as a gnomon. Because by using this gnomon, by iteration, okay, which is the idea, differential geometric idea of a connection here, of this sieve that I have just constructed, I can tile the whole hyperbolic plane, but these connections here, for me, they are connections in time, in historical time, by using the motif of information as Anadyomene. I finish here, thank you.